All right, let's try this. Maybe I don't need this just there. Hello, everybody. So today we're going to talk about JSdoc JavaScript, a way to test your JavaScript with JSdoc. First stage, we're going to follow the process step by step. So step one, you have a file, your file in JavaScript. So this is a wonderful file like that. So this is a small file, obviously. So you add two numbers, value one, value two, you return the sum of it. And you have a wonderful JSdoc comment. Here, JSdoc is quite valuable. Obviously, it is originally oriented to generate documentation, but you can see those interesting things here. The parameters. You know that value one is supposed to be a number. So if it's a string or an instance of an object or whatever, if it is not a number, this is a mistake that you have to detect. So ideally, we would like JSdoc to be respected during the execution. JSdoc helps you do that. JSdoc is an association between JavaScript and JSdoc. You take your JavaScript file, which is parsed in a special way, where we extract the JSdoc comment or include more code in order to be sure that this JSdoc is respected during execution time. All this, let's say, legwork is done by another library of mine, which is BetterJS. JSdoc produces the code all automatically. So now we take your file.javascript and we compile that with the compiler. The compiler is JSdoc.js. This compiler will produce a .betterJS file as a result. It looks exactly like that. You can find your previous function just there, value 1, value 2. We wrap that into a better function like that, and we add those wonderful new parameters. As you can see here, you specify the type of each argument. The first one is a number, the second is a number, and it returns a number. As you will execute this file instead of the original one, you will automatically detect any misuse of this function. This is the principle behind it. So we added just a bit some of line for BetterJS, but not something really important. This deletes JavaScript. We start from JavaScript plus JSdoc, and we produce yet another JavaScript file. So it is a JavaScript to JavaScript compiler. So BetterJS, what is the role of BetterJS in that? That's a library I did previously in order to produce a better JavaScript, and the name, and it provide quite a bit of feature. One of them would be to implement strong typing and private visibility. Because when you specify the type of each property, each parameter, each return value, you have in fact dynamic type checking, which is interesting for JavaScript. So let's focus on the dynamic type checking. Let's run this file that we have produced. So BetterJS will run with this file, and so make sure that the JSdoc is respected at running time. How can we check? Suppose we come without BetterJS at number 3 plus 3 returns 6. Pretty predictable. With BetterJS, same thing, no error, 3 plus 3 returns 6. Now, this is where it starts to be interesting. Without BetterJS, this foo plus 3 is non-detected. It will return foo 3. Obviously, here you have to extrapolate or not to have something that simple, that a number. Personally, at work, we run that on a big project. So obviously, it detects a lot more bug. With BetterJS, you automatically detect this. So if you have written your function a while ago, suddenly you change the parameters received by this function on somewhere very far in the code, you call this function. You forgot to port the call of the function. With this, you will be immediately notified. This is where you detect the bug much faster. What about too many arguments? Suppose you change the number of arguments in your function. If you do that without better JS, 1 plus 3 plus 5 is in fact 4, because you handle only the two first parameters. Nobody will warn you that you add a new parameter, which is not supposed to be there. If you do that with better JS, on the other hand, it is actually detected. You put 3 parameters, you're supposed to receive only 3, only 2, my bad. So it is detected. There is many other errors detected, like you can boot private on a function, and you're unsure that this function is called only from your class. You can do type on property as well. So you say that this property is always a number, cannot never be a none, for example. I do 3D for a living. This is a very interesting case. And you can do maybe some more. So this is JSdoced. How much time do I still have? A lot. So that's good, because I have other slides. If I know how to push a button, yes, I do. So all of that is pretty cool. So, but is that interesting for you to use within your own project? Meaning that, is that just something, a toy I'm playing with, or is that something that you can actually use at work? So I did another slide of deck of slide, which is, why would you use it if you were a CTO? So first, why using it? Why is it interesting to use it if you are a CTO? It's interesting because it adds dynamic type checking to JavaScript. Dynamic type checking detects a lot of new errors. This is error which is currently silently ignored. So we detect new kind of error. It takes your JavaScript with JSdoc. That means that you don't have to commit. You can do JSdoc, you can do JavaScript. You don't have to rewrite your whole application. Suppose if you wanted static type checking, you could do Dart, but you have to rewrite all your application. Another one is, it is painless to integrate, because this is JavaScript to JavaScript. So if you actually include it, you can use it and remove tomorrow. At the end, you have just more JSdoc document and no more JSdoc type checking. But it's easy to integrate and to remove. It's very interesting. So what do I mean by a CTO point of view? First, a CTO is somebody with a large code base. Here I'm meaning maybe you can use it to play around, but if you want to, if you have strong responsibility on your code, need to be runnable in 2-3 years, that means that you cannot commit to the last toy happening on the internet. The fact that we stay within JavaScript means that you can still use JSdoc today and be able to run the exact same code later. This is important when you don't, when you commit to a new language. So, first thing with JSdoc, why your CTO will use it? It is easy to learn. You already know JavaScript. You already know JSdoc. So you already know JSdoc JavaScript. You have nothing to learn. You don't need to take your team of engineers and put them in training for 2 weeks to learn the last language. Obviously, after that, it is painless to integrate, meaning that you take your JavaScript file, you can run the better JS version or the same version that should behave the same, except that in plain JavaScript, you don't do the type checking. So it's quite easy to integrate. You keep your code, you keep your documentation. There is no impact on your code base. You can easily commit to JSdoc, meaning you can integrate that in your project easily without rewriting the new application. This makes it much easier. You can easily plug it in there. After that, why plugging it? Mainly because it detects a new family of error. Every time you will do something like you change the signature of a function and you detect 2 months later that your function is called improperly, and it triggered a bug that you user have seen. You want to detect that easier, earlier. So you can impose the type of various variables, for example, the argument within a function, the return type of a function, or any properties. You can even put something called a validator, meaning that this variable can stay between 20 and 30. And if it's more than that, do an exception. You can write these kind of things. So you find a lot more bugs, especially when you integrate. Most of the time is fixing the bugs that you are fixed in the code which is detected. You will find more bugs, but that's good. Why? Because you want to find the bug before your user. And the earlier you find the bug, the faster it is to fix. You have to remember who wrote it and so on. Another interesting side effect is because you want to do the checking, you add the documentation. Because you add the documentation, you can actually generate those HTML page from JSdoc. So suddenly your code is a lot more documented. So if you use that, you have better testing and better documentation for the same price. For people who have seen my video, JSdoc crazy JavaScript guy. Just Google it. Okay, so JSdoc.js creates a virtual circle. The more you document your code, the safer it becomes. I really love that, personally. So why using JSdoc JavaScript? Because it's easy to learn, painless to integrate, and detect a new family of error, document your code, and that's it. That's the only reason to use it. That's the end. Yeah, clap. Any question? In the back.
Hi, my name is Thomas. So it seems like I'm using this extra library. It blows a lot of my code away. So it adds more complexity to my code by just producing like extra 5 lines instead of me doing an extra if statement at the beginning of my function to check the type.
Can you do manually what the compiler is doing automatically? The answer is yes, definitely. So it is more, do you want to do that or not? Can you do the job of the compiler by hand? Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's cool. Go ahead.
So do you run the better.js files in production, or is it used in like a test step where you just run and check the variables?
So now is a question that he told it over the mic. So first, do not run this code on production. No, that's not at all what you have to do, because all those tests are producing overhead, significant CPU overhead, meaning your JavaScript will be slower. It is really important if you are doing video game or stuff like that. So you use it during the development. This way, all these kind of bugs, you will see them when you develop, and you especially run that during the test phase. For those 2 periods, you don't need to have full speed. The testing, it will be a bit slower, not horribly slower, maybe 5% slower, it depends a lot of your application. But this way, you detect more bugs. You do not run that in production. This is to help you make the code safer, to test your code, not the production.
Sorry, as a follow-on question, while you're running this in dev, how long does the compile step take to run each time? Just
So the compiler is quite fast, and I provide the line in order to, you have something which watch permanently all your source file, and every time you save your new source file, this is compiled in the back, and I don't know, it depends on your code base, but this is very incremental, so you do it once. For example, we have like a 60k line, and it's one, not even 2 seconds to compile the whole application. And after that, every file, I don't know, never measured, but less than half a second for sure. You don't see it. You don't, the time to go to the browser and reload, it's already compiled. Yes.
Have you used this, like, is it only yourself, or have you used it with a team, like in a company or something, and is it, what were the results?
Yeah, thanks for your unbiased question. She's my wife. all right, so the answer that she wants me to make is my work is in fact not doing that explicitly. I do 3GS team within DACRI, we do augmented reality, blah, blah, blah. For that, we do an editor to produce content. And as I am the one doing that, I put out every pull request, no pull request, every commit that you make on pull request, we run the unit test in the back. On the unit test, it is running with that. There is absolutely no performance, no significant performance issue. If it adds 1 second to the test is like 3 hours. 1 second is really meaningless. It's working well. We find bug with that one. We are definitely happy. Any other questions? Go ahead.
Could I ask? Hello, my name is Sergey, and I have just 2 questions. First question, could it check types of complex types? I mean, not so simple like number or string, and some custom types that you just developed in your application?
Yes.
And how easy to integrate with exist framework? Because, for example, framework just give you some API, and in the TypeScript, you have just some map files that just describe what types you should provide to some framework. But what solution in your approach?
Okay, so let me remember first the first question.
Checking complex type.
Complex type, something like suppose you create a new class or your own object or you do new. So you see in JSdoced, so can you do something here? You have that. Here you can put your constructor. You can put, so I do 3GS, 3GS object 3D. So you put the name of your class here, like you do exactly in JSdoced. Here you can check like that, you can do number or string, you can do number or string or undefined. You can express quite a lot of type. So it's, all the expressivity of JSdoct is supported by JSdoct compiler. Does this answer the question? Yeah, but the complex type, define to me what do you mean by a complex type?
I just describe some pure types that has, let's say, name, age, whatever. And
you can put your own constructor.
I just create this object, not by constructor, and just by factories that just create new object and return it. And how you will check this type? And how you should I should describe in your JS?
You should describe it in such a way that either it is a basic type meaning string, number, object, all this, or it is an instance of. You know, in JavaScript, you are to know the type of a class, you do instance of. And in this case, you can, if your class, well, I don't know.
Instance of doesn't work with objects that provided by factories.
Let's talk later.
You should just use constructor, but whatever. And how we should integrate?
If you have a way to improve it, I definitely will be happy to talk with you later.
Sorry?
If you have a way to improve it, I will be definitely happy to talk with you later. Go ahead. Okay.
Can Can you selectively disable tests around particular functions or particular parameters within functions that you don't want to test for some reason? Maybe you have a good reason to use a dynamic.
There is so here you see param return all those tags according to JSdoc tag, and if you here you do at no better JS, this function will be ignored. So yeah, that's it.
Yeah, but if, for example, you ignore param, will you then get an error telling you it's the wrong number of parameters?
If you want to ignore param? Oh, you mean you compile your code, can the compiler tune to make this check or this check?
Yeah.
Currently it's not done. That's super easy to do. Ping me on GitHub and I can do that. Any other question? Apparently, yes, in the back.
Does it support regular expressions?
Like angular expressions. Define to me what is angular expression.
No, regular.
Ah, regular expression. no, here usually you put a type. What you can do, though, is to use BetterJS directly. On BetterJS directly, you can actually go much further in the description of the validator. Here, you have a validator which you pass the validation only if you are a number. You can write actually custom validator which is pass only if you match this regular expression. Okay. Yeah, you can do that.
Okay, thank you.
Cool. Thanks for all the question, by the way.
Hi. Does it have any advantages over TypeScript?
Besides the fact that this is JavaScript and do not break the backward compatibility? No. This is only advantage. Okay, significant one, though, according to me.
Yeah, I think that's enough questions.
Thanks, everybody.